Welcome to St. Francis of Assisi. Please take a moment to greet one another in the name of the Lord. Please make sure to silence your phones, alarm watches, and other electronic devices before Mass starts. The priest's intention for today's Holy Mass is for the repose of the soul of Robert Jackson. Please rise.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Happy Easter.
Peace.
We can still say, Christ is risen, alleluia.
He is risen indeed, alleluia.
And the Lord is inviting us to live those graces in a deep way today as we're celebrating Divine Mercy Sunday. And we have the Gospel of Doubting Thomas today, which is a reminder of our weakness, but also of the measure of God's love. And it's a love not to affirm us in our unloveliness, but to give us transformation and new life. The Lord calling Thomas from his doubt into new life, from his sin into freedom as a child of the Father. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Excelsis Deo, et in terra pax hominibus, bonum voluntatis, laudamus te, benedicimus te, adoramus te, glorificamus te.
Let us pray. God of everlasting mercy, who in the very recurrence of the Paschal feast Kindle the faith of the people you have made your own. Increase, we pray, the grace you have bestowed, that all may grasp and rightly understand in what font they have been washed, by whose spirit they have been reborn, by whose blood they have been redeemed, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. The community of believers was of one heart and mind, and no one claimed that any of his possessions was his own, but they had everything in common. With great power, the apostles were witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great favor was accorded them all. There was no needy person among them, for those who own property or houses will sell them, bring the proceeds of the sale, and put them at the feet of the apostles. And they were distributed to each according to need. The word of the Lord.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love is everlasting. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. Of Israel say, his mercy endures forever. Let the house of Aaron say, his mercy endures forever. Let those who fear the Lord say, his mercy endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love is everlasting. I was hard pressed and was falling, but the Lord helped me. My strength and my courage is the Lord, and he has been my Savior. The joyful shout of victory in the tents of the just. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love is everlasting. The stone which the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. By the Lord has this been done. It is wonderful in our eyes. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us be glad and rejoice in it. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love is everlasting.
A reading from the first letter of St. John. Beloved, everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ is begotten by God. And everyone who loves the Father loves also the one begotten by him. In this way, we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and obey his commandments. For the love of God is this, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments are not burdensome. For whoever is begotten by God conquers the world. And the victory that conquers the world is our faith. Who indeed is the victor over the world, but the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is the one who came through water and blood, Jesus Christ, not by water alone, but by water and blood. The Spirit is the one who testifies, and the Spirit is truth. The word of the Lord.
From the Holy Gospel according to John. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the doors were locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in their midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. Whose sins you forgive are forgiven them, and whose sins you retain are retained." Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples said to him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger into the nail marks, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." Now, a week later, his disciples were again inside, and Thomas was with them. Jesus came, although the doors were locked, and stood in their midst and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and bring your hand and put it into my side, and do not be unbelieving, but believe." Thomas answered and said to him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you come to believe because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and have believed." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples that are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that through this belief you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Happy Divine Mercy Sunday. What a great gift and grace to be able to celebrate the Lord's mercy. And of course, all of us would say, yeah, I know elements of God's mercy. I know what that means. But in fact, maybe we don't understand the roots of God's mercy towards us. So God's mercy is a mode of God's love towards us. And this mode of love is God loving us in our suffering. God approaching us in love in our woundedness. God loving us in a particular way in our brokenness, in our poverty, and the Lord not turned away from us because of our sin. God meets us where we're at and loves us into a new way of life. And I hear that, and as one who is supposed to represent the Father, I have to apologize to you for all the times that I have not acted with the Father's love. I apologize for that. Pray for me that I might live in my own life towards everyone God's mercy and his love towards perfection. And the Lord wants to reveal to us his mercy, and he's constantly trying to break through. I'm a slow learner, and so the Lord has to kind of scream for my attention. He's good at it. But I have to, like, slow down sometimes to receive that love. And I remember one time in particular, I was in Rome with my family, and we had, like, 4 hours or whatever at the Vatican Museum. And the Lord, in those moments, reached out in his mercy and love and stopped me in my tracks so that he could reveal his mercy better. And I remember saying, like, oh, my gosh, the Vatican Museums, this is incredible. I looked it up the other day. 70,000 pieces of artwork. And they have 20,000 on display. So, like, I could do the math. I got 4 hours. There's 20,000 pieces of artwork. And sure, I'd love to see all of them. And so I came up in my mind with this, of course, bright idea so that I could say, been there, done that. I got the T-shirt. And I found myself, like, at this pace, walking through the Vatican Museum, like, just blitzing past everything. And because there's so much artwork and so little space, they've got to put each piece of art right next to the one before it. And so I'm going down the hallway of the Vatican Museum on a mission. And I'm like, good, okay, nice, old, broken. Oh, I've recognized that one, seen it before. That's awesome, terrific, and just, like, I'm just going. But the Lord wanting me to receive better, I come around a corner and there's this little alcove and it's probably like 15 paintings all right next to each other in this alcove. And in the alcove was this particular painting by Guercino on today's gospel. And as I went into the alcove, I'm like, yep, 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 yep. And then the painting of Guercino. And the Lord from that painting just reached out and grabbed my heart. And I stopped in my tracks. And I just went, oh. God opened up through Guercino and his painting. God opened up his mercy. And his mercy flooded me from the wounded side of Jesus in that painting. It's Jesus standing there with a sign of his victory. And he's opened his arms and his wounded side to St. Thomas and welcomed Thomas into his wounded side, into his side, to his sacred heart. There's no condemnation. It's only love and acceptance. It's an invitation to a new life in Christ, to leave behind the former sins, the former unloveliness, to leave behind this rash oath in the gospel. He says, I will not believe unless, and here are my conditions. And Jesus' love was allowing St. Thomas to leave all of that behind for new life. New life that finds its origin in God's love, its origin in his mercy, and is made fruitful through the Lord's passion, death, and resurrection. And I was so stunned in front of this painting, I sat down on the bench, and the rest of the time I spent right there. There was nothing else in the museum as far as I was concerned. God wants us to know his love. And his love is so transformative, as I saw in this painting, that St. Thomas approached the Lord, and it's an image of his hand ready to go into the side of Jesus. But on his face, on the face of St. Thomas, was so many complex emotions. He wanted to do it, and he didn't. He wanted to be the believing one, but he wasn't. He wanted to penetrate the wall of his heart, but found in some sense that he wasn't worthy. But the invitation was so powerful that he was going to do it. I need healing. I need new life. And this is where that life is. And that mercy is available to us. And the Lord is inviting us today to renew our commitment to receive that mercy. We have in our midst a number of newly baptized. Praise the Lord. And in one sense, I'd renew, like, in some way, we're all jealous of you because of the gifts and graces that you've been given. And we rejoice in that gift that's been given you because it's a gift of life. But we ourselves can renew that gift of mercy. Every day, every morning we wake up, we're baptized. And the Lord is inviting us to live that baptism each and every day. The Lord allows us to renew that baptism when we walk into the church, and we can use the holy water, a reminder for us of our baptism and the cleansing that has come to us through the cross of Christ. We renew that gift of baptism every time we go to the confessional, confess our sins, and allow the Lord to remove the guilt. And the grace is available for us, the mercy of God, every time we come to receive the body and blood, soul and divinity of Jesus worthily, that we might have his new life. This is the gift and grace that awaits us. And our participation in this Mass, in every Mass that we're at, the Lord wants from us a bigger amen. His sacrifice on the cross, his resurrection, established for us the everlasting covenant of his love, his mercy. And every time we come before the priest or minister to receive Jesus, we're confronted with the reality of God's love. The body of Christ. And at that moment, our amen is an assent to the covenant he established. It's an invitation for God to pour upon us the blood and water from his wounded side. It's our opportunity to say yes to life. Father, we thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus, and the life that he offers. Help us, even in our woundedness, even in our poverty, even in our sin and unloveliness, to say yes to the offer of grace, of salvation, of new life. Overcome, Lord, the obstacles that we place in your way. Overcome them. Win us over. Win us over through love, so that we might live the life you offer. We make our prayer through Jesus, who is Lord forever and ever. Amen. So in the past weeks, I'm sure all of you have looked up and seen the new rectory, and it's moving along really nicely. And it survived last night. It survived. We're blessed to have that. And so now we're extending the opportunity for the parish to engage more deeply in our campaign, A Future Full of Hope.
Happy Divine Mercy Sunday to you all. It brings me great joy to stand before you today to give you the update on the Rectory Project and our Future Full of Hope campaign. If you don't know, my name is Michael. This is Evelyn. Had to double check. And I have had the pleasure of serving on the Rectory Committee over the last number of months. I want to start by just giving a brief overview of the vision for the project. You've probably heard this before, so I'll make it brief. We're going to have four suites in this rectory, each with a bedroom, a sitting room, and a bathroom. And the suites will serve our pastor, our parochial vicar, a seminarian, and a retired priest. And for those of you who are wondering if Father Frank will be that retired priest, he had this to say. As of now, I am very happy living in Northeast Longmont. I would love to see another retired priest live in the new rectory to provide extra help for the many parishes in the area.
And I think, Father Frank, if you were here, he might have said it a little differently. He might have said, I would love to see another priest helping in the area.
The rectory will also include a shared living space for the priests, a backyard, covered patio, a garden area, and a prayer space, and a small library. Now for the construction update. You can see the exterior is coming along quite nicely. You can see the finishings going up on that. If you go inside, the drywall has gone up. They were doing mudding this week. So you really get a sense for the space. And I can tell you that, but you really can't understand what I'm talking about unless you go inside. And so we're going to start offering regular tours so that every parishioner who wants to has a chance to see the progress of the rectory over the next coming months. And we'll talk more about that a little bit later. The next major milestones are flooring, trim, countertops, cabinets, electrical and plumbing finishes. So we're really getting close there. And then we'll get to the landscaping part as well. Overall, I would say that the project has been tremendously blessed by the Lord and all of the work that's gone on. And I can say that we are on time to finish and open the doors in September of this year.
We've had real evidence that the Lord is in the middle of this project, and one particular event happened. Steve, who's our architect, general contractor, and also a parishioner, said, Father, you got to meet our plumber. So finally, I got out to meet Richard. Richard is in his 60s, and he says, Father, there's something going on with this project. He's not Catholic. And I was like, yep, I know. St. Joseph's in charge of this project. And he's like, Father, you need to know this. In my work, in all my years as a plumber, I've seen 11 times as a plumber this particular thing happen. 11 times. He said, there'll be a pipe and it comes to an end, and another pipe and it comes to an end. And then he's up on a ladder and he says, oh, I got to cut another piece of pipe to fit perfectly that space. And then he says, and I've looked on the ground 11 times in my career and thought, huh, maybe that extra piece of pipe there will fit. And he said he's gone down 11 times and taken the piece of pipe and he's put it up, and the pipe has fit perfectly 11 times. And he said, Father, out of those 11, fully 5 times on this project alone has that happened. And I'm like blown away. And I was like, that's St. Joseph. The Lord is in the midst of this project and he wants to pour out his love and his mercy on us in so many ways. And Steve and I went off and did more of the tour. We're in the kitchen. And Richard walks in with a big smile on his face, holding a piece of pipe, and he says, 12.
So very, very blessed. And then on the campaign side, we've been blessed as well. We've been trying to work through as much of the parish as we can over the last few months to ask every parishioner to contribute to this campaign. And I can tell you now that I'm excited that we're before you, because we had a goal. We wanted to get to at least 70% of our $2.3 million goal before we came in front of the parish. And as of today, we have raised $1.72 million with the help of over 230 parishioners. So thank you to all of you who are here today, who have taken your own initiative to either donate to the campaign or have met with us to make a pledge for the campaign. $1.72 million is a lot of money, and we still got some work to go.
The finish line is in sight for the $2.3 million goal. And our rectory committee firmly believes that not only can we reach our goal, but that we can do it without long-term debt. And additionally, we hope to go over the goal so that we can establish an endowment for the maintenance and the upkeep of the rectory so that there's not a long-term financial burden for the parish. So with your help today, and with the Lord's mercy and his love, we can achieve these goals. So I invite you now, if you haven't already, to prayerfully consider a 5-year pledge to our Future Full of Hope campaign.
And we're going to do this right now. So if you may have noticed as you come in, we've got pledge cards at the end of the pew. So if you would take a moment, pass those down. I want every family, even if you've donated, even if you've pledged, to grab one of those pledge cards, and I want you to hold it in the air. I don't want anybody to feel left out. So everybody grab it. When you have yours, hold it up. Nobody's holding up. Chantel, a little higher for me. Newly Catholic. There she goes. She's the highest in the church. Good job, Chantel. Good job, Sharon. If you've got your card, hold it up for me. Great. Okay, you can put it down now. And put it down. Take the pen or pencil that's there as well, and take the time to fill out this pledge card. If you've already pledged the campaign, then write a prayer intention. Find a spot, write some prayer intentions so that this entire project, this entire campaign, can be an offering to the Lord.
Consider the impact this rectory will have on you and on your family. A spiritual father by your side in your hour of need, and not only for you, but for your children and even your grandchildren. The presence of clergy at events at the rectory will all give us insight into the lives and ministry of our priests, our clergy, and will foster appreciation and greater relationships with our priests, as well as future vocations. It'll have a huge impact on our parish. We know that Mercy Sundays are very well-attended events, as we have somebody, a priest, sitting in the confessional. What a great blessing, which, of course, we've recognized over the past year, it's only happened when we have another priest who's around helping. There'll be increased availability for confessions, for all of the sacraments, and a presence beyond the sacraments, as priests will be much closer and more available to be present to the ministries, activities in our parish.
So hopefully we've given you enough time here to start filling out that card. Ushers, if you wouldn't mind taking the collection past the basket. And if you've filled out that card, whether it's your prayer intention or a pledge to this campaign, just put it in the basket. Now, I know some of you may have not had enough time to consider this. That's okay. Bring your pledge card back next weekend, the weekend after that. Drop it in the collection basket. You can also drop it off at the office, at the parish office, give it straight to Louise. All of that is a wonderful thing. So as the ushers take this collection here, I just want to say thank you again for your great generosity. We have ambassadors who will be present after Mass today. They'll have hard hats and vests. You won't be able to miss them if you try. They'll be there to answer questions that you have, as well as help you schedule a tour. We're going to have tours regularly scheduled on Tuesdays at 1, Fridays at 9, our first Saturdays and second Sundays in the months to come. So plenty of opportunities there. You can also do that at our website, sfassisi.org/rectory. We want to invite you over there to really see for yourself the work the Lord is doing on the rectory and through us.
The ushers are coming around now to collect the pledge cards. And if you want to take time at home to contemplate what the Lord's inviting you to give, please do that. And as you come back next week, or if you want to come in the middle of the week and pass that in at the front desk, feel free to do that. This is a great way for us to commit ourselves to the work that the Lord has begun in the parish. The Lord wants to do so much, and with more priests in our parish, we'll be able to better bring Jesus to others and better bring others to Jesus. He's the one who does the ministry, not us. And to have more priestly presence is going to be an incredible source of fruitfulness. Thank you so much for your generosity. And please continue prayers for the success of our campaign, A Future Full of Hope. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. And as Michael said, after Mass, you'll see people in hard hats and vests. They can answer any questions that you have about the campaign or even about the rectory, about the build. And we want to set up a time for anyone who desires to see the new rectory and to get a vision. And you'll be very happy to know that in the chapel, those 2x6s that we all signed our names to, our prayer intentions, we made sure, and we have photos of it, that they're in the chapel and associated with the chapel, so that our prayers, our lives, our hearts might always be present to the work that the Lord is doing in there and through there to our community and beyond. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us men and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and he came down. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God above. He will come in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
We stand united as brothers and sisters in confidence. We're confident in our Father's love for us, and so we lift to him now our needs.
That the Church may continue to grow in charity and faith as she remains a sign of God's merciful love for all. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the Lord may look favorably upon and provide the resources for the needs of individuals and communities. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all who have been separated from God by sin may experience forgiveness and healing through the sacrament of reconciliation. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all of us gathered here may be guided by the Holy Spirit in our work to build up the kingdom of God on earth by our words and actions. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the faithful departed may be welcomed into the kingdom of heaven and see the face of God. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the repose of Robert Jackson, for whom this Mass is being said, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Father of mercy and love, we entrust to your care these our needs and our very lives. Pour upon us your mercy and love so that we might find new life in your Son, Jesus, who is Lord forever and ever.
Amen.
And now we invite forward the children with their stewardship offerings. Pray, sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church.
Accept, O Lord, we pray, the oblations of your people and of those you have brought to a new birth, that renewed by confession of your name and by baptism, they may attain unending happiness. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord. Let
us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation at all times, to acclaim you, O Lord, but on this day above all, to laud you yet more gloriously when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For he is the true Lamb who has taken away the sins of the world. By dying, he has destroyed our death, and by rising, restored our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread. And giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. In giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. As we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Francis, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Samuel, our Bishop, Jorge, his assistant, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There, we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Thank you.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that our reception of this Paschal Sacrament may have a continuing effect in our minds and hearts through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Calling all extroverts and social butterflies. We are building a team of hospitality champions to meet individuals at our parish events, connect with them through meaningful conversation, and invite them to future events at our parish. If you are interested in joining, please follow the instructions in the bulletin. Please join us today at 3 p.m. to pray together the Chaplet of Divine Mercy. Let's continue our Easter celebration. Join us in St. Clair Hall right after Mass for the best coffee and donuts in town. Do you want to know what makes them the best? You do. So don't miss out. Next Friday at 6 p.m., join us for a very special holy hour. We will have Eucharistic adoration, and a professional choir will be singing sacred music to support our prayer. This will not be a concert, but a time of contemplation, prayer, and thanksgiving. Please join us. There are a lot more things going on in the parish. Make sure to take a bulletin home to stay in the loop. Stephen Ministry is hosting an information night on dementia and Alzheimer's on Monday, April 15th from 6 to 7:15 p.m. in St. Clair Hall. All are welcome. And now those who are celebrating birthdays and baptisms, please stand up for a blessing.
So celebrating birthdays, baptisms, anniversaries in the month of April, stand to claim your blessing. May the Lord pour out upon you his mercy and grace this month, so that you might rejoice in his love and live that love towards others. May the Lord bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow down for the blessing. May God, who by the resurrection of his only begotten Son was pleased to confer on you the gift of redemption and of adoption, give you gladness by his blessing.
Amen.
Really, only some of you want that blessing? Yeah, I mean, and it gets better. Each one is better than the previous. May he, by whose redeeming work you have received the gift of everlasting freedom, make you heirs to an eternal inheritance.
Amen.
And may you, who have already risen with Christ in baptism through faith, by living in a right manner on this earth, be united with him in the homeland of heaven.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit come down on you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Go in peace. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God.
Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world seeking the ruin of souls. And for our rectory project, we pray, remember, O most gracious Virgin Mary, that never was it known that anyone who fled to thy protection, implored thy help, or sought thy intercession was left unaided. Inspired by this confidence, I fly unto thee, O Virgin of Virgins, my Mother. To thee do I come, before thee I stand, sinful and sorrowful. O Mother of the Word Incarnate, despise not my petitions, but in your mercy hear and answer me. Amen.